Dear students, welcome to presentation on feed water control. This is a topic in module 5 of power plant instrumentation. This is being presented by Vimal Kumar V, assistant professor, department of applied electronics and instrumentation, Tazity School of Engineering and Technology. Feed water control. In drum type boilers, the flow of feed water to boiler drum is normally controlled in order to hold the level of water in the steam drum as close as possible to normal water level set point. A typical level control loop will be inadequate due to shrink and swell characteristic of boilers. See, this is a typical boiler drum arrangement. We can see this is the boiler drum. This is the water level to which it is to be maintained. So normal water level, NWL, as was seen in the previous slide. Then this is downcomer. It is a tube from the boiler drum so that water comes down from that. That is downcomer. Then on the right side, we have riser tube. It is through this that the water which has come down through the downcomer rises because of heat from the combustion chamber. It will get heated, it will get lighter, and the water will rise through the riser and getting heated to a greater level, it gets converted to steam. So please note that below the water level of the steam drum, we have a mixture of water as well as steam. So the volume will depend on the percentage of water as well as steam. If steam is more, the density will be less. But for a given mass, the volume will be more. Now, there are two factors that need to be considered. One thing is swell. This concept comes like this. At any point in time, the boiler contains a certain mass of water and steam bubbles below the surface of water in the steam drum. For this mass of water, the steam, there is an average mixture density. For this mass of water and steam, there is an average mixture density. So it has an average density. As long as the boiler steaming rate is constant, that is, boiler is generating steam at a constant rate, the steam water mixture has the same volumetric proportions and the average mixture density is constant. That is, the level will remain constant and the average mixture density will also be constant. Volumetric proportion of steam and water will remain constant because the proportion, how much steam is present or how much water will be present, that will remain constant as far as the steaming rate is constant, and also the density will also remain constant. Now, if the boiler load increase, that means that it has to generate more steam. So heat will has to be increased and below the water level, more steam bubbles will have to come. So what happens is that the volumetric proportion in water steam mixture change. And naturally, steam should increase. Mass almost remains same, but the proportion of steam increases. That will result in an increase in volume, though the mass almost remains same. Since the mass of water and steam at this point has changed very insignificant, that is, there is not much change in mass, but the average density has decreased. And if mass has to remain same and density has decreased, there should be an increase in volume of the steam water mixture. This is called swelling. And this can occur only if volume increases. This causes an immediate increase in the drum water level, even though additional water has not been added. This effect of sudden increase in drum water level as the steaming rate is increased is known as swell. Shrink. This is just an opposite concept. When the steam load is reduced, there are fewer steam bubbles in the mixture, that is below the water level in the drum. Steam bubbles decrease and average density of mixture increases. Mass almost remains constant, but density has increased because steam has lower density and water has more density, and steam bubbles has decreased. Net mass almost remains constant, but the proportion of water has increased and the proportion of steam bubbles have decreased. So average density of mixture increases, thus volume will have to go down and the volume of steam water mass decreases. The effect is an immediate reduction in the drum water level, although the mass of water and steam has not changed. This sudden reduction of drum water level on a decrease in steaming rate is called shrink. So we have seen what swell is and what shrink is. Because of these two effects, a simple level control loop is usually inadequate for feed water control in a boiler drum. Now there is another term called water inventory. The amount of water in the boiler at any given time can be called the water inventory of the boiler. If the water has swelled due to an increase in steaming rate, the water inventory must be reduced to bring drum water level down to normal water level. We have seen a dotted line previously. The water level has to be maintained at that line. If the water has shrunk due to decrease in steaming rate, the water inventory must be increased to return the water level to the NWL or normal water level. This is the typical arrangement for transmitting the level. So this is the level transmitter. This works on differential pressure principle. We can see that the connections of steam are taken from a height h of 1. This is the head of the steam. Head of the steam above the water level. That is h of 1. And similarly, in the bottom connection, the head of water above the bottom connection is h of 2. And again, the steam comes in, goes to a condensation port from the topmost connection. You can see from the topmost connection, it goes to a condensation port and it condenses and becomes water. And there is a column of liquid that is formed, which creates a head H of 3. H of 3 above the lower connection. Below the lower connection, either be it on the left side, that is left side connection, or on the right side connection, both have equal heads. The additional head for the right side connection, that is the high pressure side, you can see L and H. L stands for low pressure side and H stands for high pressure side. The high pressure side has an additional head H of 3, as can be seen from the figure. Now, the net pressure on the low pressure side is the pressure due to steam in the boiler plus the head due to H of 1 plus the head due to H of 2, and then of course the head due to what remains till L. But since that is common, we are measuring differential pressure, and the height is common, below H of 3, we can neglect that. So we can say effective pressure at L is actually H of 1 plus H of 2 plus the pressure which has been developed in the boiler. Now on the other side, on the right hand side, for H, the pressure will be the pressure generated in the boiler due to steam, and H of plus H of 3. Now since it is a differential pressure measurement, we have the pressure in the boiler common for both L and H, so that will cancel out, and what we get is that the net pressure will be H of 3 minus of H of 1 plus H of 2, as can be seen from the figure in the equation. Net transmitter pressure differential is H of 3 minus H of 1 plus H of 2. So please observe that when the level of water rises, H of 2 increases, and from the equation the transmitter output should decrease. So when level rises, the transmitter output should decrease. The transmitter is a differential pressure device in which the output signal increases as the differential pressure decreases. On the high pressure side of the measuring device, the effective pressure equals boiler drum pressure plus the weight of a water column H of 3 at ambient temperature. On the low pressure side, the effective pressure equals boiler drum pressure plus the weight of a column of saturated steam H of 1 plus the weight of a column of water H of 2 at saturation temperature. Please note that these are taken at corresponding temperature. The columns are considered at their corresponding temperatures. Since the instrument measures differential pressure, the boiler drum pressure cancels out as was previously explained. It leaves only the column pressure differences. The density, so we are considering H of 1, H of 2, H of 3, these are column pressures or heads. But the density of saturated steam and water at saturation temperature changes as drum pressure changes. It is not a constant, it changes with pressure. So the signal from the measuring transmitter has to be corrected for different pressures. If we have taken a reference for at a particular pressure, then it will have to be corrected for different pressure. The signal from the measuring transmitter can be corrected for all pressures by providing a drum pressure measurement. So we have to measure the drum pressure separately, then provide appropriate corrections. It can be used to, now this correction, first, number one, the density changes. Due to that, span changes. That is, what is the lower value and what is the upper value? That is upper value minus lower value. That is span. That changes. Now, it should start, usually start from only one reading. So, you should make some addition such that it always starts from zero. Something like that. So, we call that bias. To adjust span, we should multiply a correction value as has been. That is, this multiplication, what should be multiplied will depend on the pressure which is measured. That is, the value to be multiplied is a function of pressure measured, and also the value of bias to be added is also a function of pressure. This can be seen from this diagram. You can see the drum level is corrected based on measurement from pressure transmitter PT. Drum level as measured by LT is corrected by the measurement taken from drum pressure, and we are calculating F of P, that is a function of the pressure, and multiplication is done to change the span, and addition is done to adjust for bias. The computation arrangement adds and multiply signals. The bias or signal, to sum up, is a calibration value in inches of water that represents difference in 100% level calibration at a particular pressure compared to the calibration value at the base pressure condition. That is, this bias is simply obtained by, you first of all, there is a reference pressure, what we call base pressure. At that time for 100% level, what is the value? That will be subtracted from the new value at the given pressure. The bias or signal to some arc is a calibration value, and it is having a unit of inches of water. So first we will take 100% level value at the given pressure. After that, we will subtract 100% value when the reference pressure was used. We will obtain the bias time. The multiplication changes the calibration span as water in the drum changes density due to change in pressure. The multiplication term usually corrects for density changes. The values of bias and multiplication are based on a series of calculations that use different drum pressure data. Now, the control objectives are: control the drum level to a set point, minimize the interaction with combustion control system, make smooth changes in boiler water inventory as boiler load changes, properly balance the boiler steam output with the feed water input, compensate for feed water pressure variation without process upset or set point shift. These are the control objectives that should be satisfied. Now, apart from this, we have to take care that the various parameters, that is steam flow, feed water flow, boiler drum level, changes in a smooth manner, as can be seen from this. See, we can see NWL, normal water level, under conditions of swell and shrink. Now, there is a change in steam flow rate because of load change, steam flow changes. Now, according to that, accordingly, we should change the water flow so that we have to maintain, so that we can maintain the level constant. NWL should be maintained constant. So this is a pattern which is desirable. Okay, there is no sudden change. The correct action as shown in figure is for feed water flow to make no immediate change, but rather to gradually change the water inventory as indicated by the return of drum water level to set point. As steam flow increases, an increase in feed water would be indicated if boiler drum level did not swell. See, if the rate of steam which is needed, the rate at which steam has to be provided increases, so water gets converted to steam, naturally water will get depleted in the boiler drum. So that should be compensated by an increase in feed water. But the condition is that if there is swell, then the level will increase out of proportion. We are assuming for a given mass. Okay. So under condition when swell is absent, if steam flow increases, additional feed water should be supplied. The drum level increase should cause a reduction in feed water flow if the steam flow had not increased. Okay. Drum level increase should cause a reduction in feed water flow if steam flow had not increased. Suppose that steam flow remains constant and suddenly, or by some reason, the level of water in the drum increases. So to maintain it at constant value, we should reduce the feed water flow. The proper adjustment of feed water control system balances these opposing influences. See, these are acting in opposite way, isn't it? If first case we are assuming that there is no swell and we are assuming that steam flow is increasing, and in the second case we are assuming that steam flow is constant but level of drum is increasing, maybe due to swell, So under both these circumstances, the action needed is quite opposite. So we should find a balance between these two, because cell is not absent and also steam flow is not constant. So based on which should be more considered, which should be considered more important, based on that control action should be taken. Proper balance of feed water control influences. If the influence of drum level is too great, the initial control action will be to reduce feed water flow. This will ultimately cause drum level to move beyond the control set point to make up for the lost water flow. This is what is being told. We are assuming that the level, drum level influence is more. That is, we can assume that steam flow rate is almost constant. Suppose we assume that. That is, it is not of great importance. We can neglect that. In that case, we are going for the second strategy. That is, we should decrease the feed water flow to maintain the drum level constant. This is the control. This is how, if proper balance of feed water control for drum level influence which is too great. Now, if the influence of steam flow is too great, first we should increase the feed water flow. This action will prolong the time period that the drum level is above the set point. So this is the case. So we are assuming that influence of steam flow is too great. So we are assuming, we are increasing the feed water flow gradually. Okay. Now, single element feed water control. That is, we are simply using a level control loop. Control of feed water that relies only on a measurement of drum level will be adequate only on smaller boilers. Here we assume that it have a relatively large water volume and a relatively slow change in load. This is the diagram. Simple feed water control. We have level transmitter, which is the output of which is fed to a controller, and that controller has a delta, which is the error obtained by subtracting LT with set point. And the controller has K, that is a proportional gain K, and an integral term. Now, based on that, it generates the control output, and that is given to a control valve to manipulate feed water flow. Changes in level is fed back to a control function as was shown. The controller includes an error detector function which measures the error between the primary variable and the set point. The control function preferred is proportional plus integral as was shown. A change in the controller output changes feed water flow by the control valve. Usually this control valve should have a linear characteristic. Now we have seen that we have to see how it performs also. So here we can see the control action for a single element feedback control. Here you can see certain portions are marked in asterisk. This shows interaction with firing rate control due to imbalance between steam flow and feed water flow. So here we are comparing steam flow, feed water flow, as well as water level, drum level. Two element feed water control. It has standard feed forward plus feedback control loop. The feed forward signal is usually taken from steam flow. It anticipates a need for additional feed water flow. The feedback control from drum water level is shown as proportional control. See, please see, this is the two element feed water control. Here LT measures the level and FT steam flow. The steam flow is measured by usually a DPT, and it has square root relation. That is why a square root is indicated. And From that, we obtain feed forward signal so that the final control signal is obtained by the control signal from the usual feedback control from LT, that is level controller feedback control signal, as well as the feed forwarder controller for FT using the signal from FT. Both of these are added together to obtain the final controller output, which manipulates the feed water flow. The control valve is characterized so that control signal versus feed water flow is linear. This is the desired pattern of relation obtained for constant pressure. See, this satisfies our previous pattern criteria. There is no sudden change. But if the feed water pressure was varying, it is not satisfactory. Now we will move to three element feed water control. It has feedback, feed forward, and cascade control. Feed forward is again obtained from the measurement of steam flow, but here we are using feed water flow also. We are measuring feed water flow also, and it acts as a slave loop for cascade control. And the set point for this slave controller, that is feed water flow control, is taken from the controller output from the level control loop as well as the feed forward control. Both of the controls are summed together to obtain the set point for feed water flow controller. It has feedback, feed forward, and cascade controls. Steam flow is the feed forward signal that anticipates a need for additional feed water flow. It feedbacks measurements of drum level and feed water flow to implement cascade control with feed water flow control loop as slave. The set point for feed water control loop is generated by summing control outputs of drum level controller and feed forward controller. This is an alternate arrangement. You can see F of T. This F of T is used to filter out noises in the process. So the problems due to noises are eliminated in this arrangement. Now the performance is quite good. You can see these are the references. Thank you.